get out. I'll get out of all your boxes. I'll get out. You can't hold me in these chains. I'll get out. Father, free me from this bondage. Knowing my condition is the reason I must change. Your stinking resolution is no type of solution. Preventing me from freedom, maintaining your pollution. I won't support your lie no more. I won't even try no more. If I have to die, oh Lord, that's how I choose to live. I won't be compromised no more. I can't be victimized no more. I just don't sympathize no more. 'Cause now I understand. You just wanna use me. You say love then abuse me. Never thought you'd lose me, but how quickly we forget that nothing is for certain. You thought I'd stay here hurting. Your guilt trip's just not working, repressing me to death. 'Cause now I'm choosing life, yo. I'll take the sacrifice, yo. If everything must go, then go. That's how I choose to live.
Okay, we're getting there. At least I had a chunk. Okay, it's how I choose to live.
No more compromises. I see past your disguises. Blinding through mind control. Stealing my eternal soul. Appealing through material. To keep me as your slave. But I'll get out. Oh, I'll get out of all your boxes. I'll get out. You get. Oh, and you ain't seen nothing yet. Oh, I don't care if you're upset. I could care less if you're upset. See, you don't change the truth. And your hurt feelings no excuse to keep me in this box. Psychological locks, repressing true expression, cementing this repression, promoting mass deception so that no one can be healed. I don't respect your system. I won't protect your system. When you talk, I don't listen. Oh, let my father's will be done. And just get out. Oh, just get out of all this bondage. Just get out. Oh, you can't hold me in these chains. Just get out. Oh, these traditions killing freedom. Knowing my condition is the reason I must change. Just accepted what you said, keeping me among the dead. The only way to know is to walk, then learn, then grow. But faith is not your speed, or you'd have everyone believe that you're the sole authority. Just follow the majority, afraid to face reality. The system is a joke, or you'd be smart to save your soul. Oh, and escape this mind control. You spend your life in sacrifice to a system for the dead. Oh, are you sure? Where's the passion in this living? Are you sure it's God you're serving? Obligated to a system, getting less than you're deserving. Who made up these schools, I say? Who made up these rules, I say? Animal conditioning, or just to keep us as a slave, or just get out of this social purgatory. Just get out. Oh, these traditions are a lie. Just get out. Superstition killing freedom. Knowing my condition is the reason I must die. Just get out.
unusual for somebody to introduce themselves, but I'm going to do it today. And unfortunately, I'm under a very tight schedule because my plane was scheduled to depart at 6, and so I have to make the message as potent as I can in the limited amount of time that I have. But I would like to start by introducing myself. My name is Sister Soldier, and soldier is a word that describes somebody who is a fighter. One thing that I consider myself is a fighter for the liberation of African people worldwide, and that is why I call myself a soldier. The reason why I spell it S-O-U-L-J-A-H is because we as an African people are known to have soul and spirit. Spirit meaning a relationship with God, spirit meaning a relationship with many worlds. And so soul means the essence of all things. So I attempted to take a term like soldier, which means fighter, which sounds kind of bland and kind of hard, and add some flair to it as an African woman, which is why I spell it S-O-U-L-J-A-H. I was born and raised in the Bronx, New York City, grew up in a single female parented household, 18 years under the welfare system, which we know is a system that many African people in particular and disproportionately are familiar with in America. I'm also a product of a church background, non-denominational Christian church, and have had a lot of Islamic influence in terms of my collegiate education. I'm a student at Rutgers University, and I've also studied at the University of Salamanca in Spain. I have traveled to Africa on a few occasions, where I worked in a medical center in Zimbabwe in a place called Emtepa Tepa. The majority of my activism has been around issues such as apartheid in Southern Africa, and also around homeless children. I had a camp for homeless children that operated in North Carolina for 3 years, which took children of homeless families that lived in what is called welfare hotels, which are hotels that are converted to accommodate homeless people, but accommodate is probably like the worst word to describe it. What actually happens is the entire family lives inside of one room, so you have 5 people living in one room, and you have landlords in that particular area making a whole bunch of money off of the backs of homeless people. So we developed a camp called the African Youth Survival Camp, where we took young brothers and sisters out to North Carolina for 3 consecutive years and taught them different things like African manhood, African womanhood, health, hygiene, reading, writing, arithmetic, the ability to survive in today's society, what is the nature of racism, and how did you get in the predicament that you're in, and what are the organizational styles you can use to get out of that predicament. Also, I have an organization in New York City called Soul Sisters Incorporated, where we have other African women in a sisterhood to try to develop a situation where we can be more instrumental in developing our community and having a relationship with our community. One of the most important things that I think I have to express in any college campus that I go to is the need for college students and the college university to have a relationship with community people. Usually there is a strong desire among collegiate people to have a relationship with community people, but that relationship in a practical sense does not exist. That relationship in a practical sense is not happening. Usually that doesn't happen is because in an educational system, what you get is your mind arranged in a particular way based on a reaction to a particular culture. So when you return to your community, usually you are divorced from the ways, the mannerisms, the style of living, the mode of expression of the people that live in it. And so one of the themes that I would like to express is the need for us as African students in particular to have a stronger relationship with our community. And in doing so, we should not become strangers in the community, but should be able to embrace the community and develop them in some way as we develop ourselves from learning from them. Main message that I spread wherever I go in the country is that we as a people are at war. When I say we are at war, what I mean is a state of war exists anytime anybody tries to take from you that which is rightfully yours. It could be your life, your liberty, your pursuit of happiness, your education, your ability to move along freely in a society from point A to point B. A state of war exists anytime anybody or any system organizes against you to take your life, your liberty, your pursuit of happiness, your proper education, your ability to move from point A to point B. So So we as an African people are at war. Whether or not we choose to acknowledge it is one thing or another. But as you know, if you ignore the fact that you're in a state of war, the end result usually is that you will be smashed by the fact that it exists and you have taken no actions to organize yourself. I think it's important that we also understand some basic definitions so that we understand who we're talking about even when we say we. When I use the term we, I'm talking about African people. When I say African people, I mean those people who come from the continent of Africa who were dropped off in various places around the world. So if you're from Grenada, if you're from Panama, if you're from Guyana, if you're from Jamaica, if you're from certain parts of Latin America, these are all black people dropped off in different places in the world. That is who I'm talking about when I'm talking about African people. Why do I stress the importance of Africa? Africa is not just a power base and a land base, it's a way of life. And I think it's important for us as a people to recognize that. First of all, I think the reason why we reject Africa is because of the way that we have been portrayed in the United States media. Usually when you see pictures of Africa or commercials about Africa, what you see is a black baby with a big head and a bloated stomach. You'll see flies buzzing all over the place. Then you'll see some white woman who will come out and say, excuse me, I'm Sally Struthers. This is Abdullah. Abdullah doesn't have any food. His people have forgotten how to plant seeds. And he doesn't have a father. And you'll be surprised what 50 cents can do for Abdullah. So if you can just put it in an envelope and send it to us, we will be able to take care of him, his family, and his entire community. Now, the normal African reaction to that is to reject that particular image, because that's not an image that gives you a feeling of pride. That's not an image that makes you want to claim that particular land. And that's not an image that wants you to makes you want to claim that particular people. If you see a documentary on Africa, usually you will see some naked African people running around. You'll have some white British narrator who's trying to explain what these people are doing, and he usually has absolutely no idea what these people are doing. And you might see some type of a ceremony which involves some type of blood or some type of rituals that are never understood, never explained by the people who claim to narrate and own the footage of the film. And so what has happened is you're reinforced in a negative way about yourself. And so your self-image makes you reject yourself. And when you reject yourself, quite naturally, you destroy yourself, your community, and your own people. Most of the images of young African men today are images of criminals. Usually you can turn on the news at 5 or 6 or 7 p.m. and see several young black men being carted away by the police. Usually their heads are down, their hands are to the back, or their arms are up, leaning up against the wall or something of that nature. So the image of African people is not something that is something that African people ourselves would want to embrace. Usually, if you see an African woman on the United States media, it is something that is, she is someone who is portrayed in a negative light. She is someone who is portrayed as some type of a hooker, prostitute, oversexed, somebody who is not intelligent, one-dimensional, flat, so on and so forth. And so as a people, the main thing that we have to struggle against is embracing ourselves and rejecting the cultures of other people in terms of our own definition and understanding who we are. So I stand before you as an African woman, and I say, when I say we, I mean African people. Africa also represents a way of life and a way of thinking. To give you an example, in America, most things are based on rugged individualism. I, me, and go for self is the basic philosophy, which comes out of a capitalistic thought process. In Africa, the word I means we. I is we, and we is them, and them is they, and they is us, and us is I, and I am you, and you is I. So in an African philosophy, we are all interlocked to one another. So there's no way if you're doing bad that I can be doing good. If you're doing bad, I'm doing bad. If you're doing good, I'm doing good. So it's a philosophy that exists. And what happens is this is a philosophy that makes for a better community, makes for a better global system, makes for a better way of life. And when we reject Africa, we reject ourselves, our culture, our philosophy, our ways of thinking. Africa also represents a land base. Usually, people can travel all around the world, and based on what color or what culture you come from, you represent what your land base looks like. For instance, you can see an Italian person. stories about their history they'll feel very proud about. You can see a Spanish person that will claim Spain, that will tell you about their history and feel proud about it. You can see a Japanese person that can travel around the world and because of the state of affairs in Japan, can feel proud about being from Japan and also represents a certain amount of power because of the state of the Japanese economy presently. You can see people from different ethnic backgrounds, but when we as African people move throughout the world, one thing that is commonly known about us is that the majority of us reject our natural selves. The majority of us reject our home base. The majority of us don't move to develop our home base. And so we represent, when we move around the world, a state of confusion and a state of misunderstanding. African people develop a way of life which taught young men what is the definition of being a man, which taught young women what is the definition of being a woman. Since we have rejected Africa and rejected the philosophy, we have a lot of young brothers and sisters in America, the majority I would say, who don't have any understanding of what it is to be a man or what it is to be a woman. So the societies that organized in ancient Africa would get together and the older women would tell younger women stories about how to deal with your relationship, how to get the fruits to the market, how to create an economic base for the family, would teach men how to be hunters, how to organize things. And so since these things have been removed and our people have been devastated, most people are not understanding how to do certain basic fundamental things as African men and African women. So we get our definitions from the television. So you have the average young black male in the inner city area believing that the definition of being a man is being a criminal. The definition of being a man is shooting people, being shot, being incarcerated, doing time in particular hardcore correctional facilities. You have young women who get their definition of womanhood from Erica Kane on All My Children, who get their definition of womanhood from Joan Collins on Dynasty, who get their definition of womanhood from white women who are divorced from their same historical understanding, divorced from their same historical experience, who didn't grow up in the projects, didn't grow up in the inner cities, and won't have the problems that are particular to African women. So when you reject your African self, you not only reject your power base, which the rest of the entire world recognizes represents a certain amount of resources, which the rest of the entire world recognizes represents a strategic military position, which the rest of the entire world represents certain mineral wealth and resource wealth. But when you fail to recognize that yourself, you fail to establish a relationship, to embrace the continent, and to develop a relationship on any level, emotional, business, social, philosophical, militarily, and as a result, you have an entire landmass that goes undeveloped for our people. Racism is a system that, based on race, denies people access to life, to liberty, to the pursuit of happiness, to proper education, to control over their own resources. Racism is a system which denies people access based on race to those particular things. So what does that mean? That means that this term that they use, reverse racism, does not exist. Reverse racism as a term is a contradiction in words because it insinuates that somewhere along the line, we as African people, evened up the economic score, received some type of reparations, developed institutions of education where we taught masses of white people to hate themselves and destroy themselves, developed industry where we taught African people to be producers and taught all whites to be consumers, developed a military where we drafted all white people and sent them to fight black battles. Racism is a system. So anybody who wants to know the definition of racism must know that it is a system that is predicated on the notion of power. If you as a race do not have the power to systematically deny people access to life, to liberty, to proper education, to industry, to money making, to controlling your environment, you cannot be considered a racist. So what is an African person? who feels bad about white people? What is an African person who feels annoyed about racism? What is an African brother that stands on the corner and says, you know, I'm tired of all of these whiteies? What word do we use to define him? The word that we use is prejudice. Prejudice means to prejudge a situation. And I would advise all people, as an African woman who is also a historian, that you should prejudge every situation that you encounter in the United States of America. What do I mean by that? Well, if somebody's great-great-great-grandfather had stabbed my great-great-great-grandfather in the back, and then their great-great-grandfather had lied and cheated and stolen land from my great-great-grandfather, and then their great-grandfather had raped my great-grandmother, and then the grandfather had cheated and manipulated my grandfather, and father had lied and stolen from my father, what would make me think that their sons and daughters would not do the same thing? Wouldn't I in fact then be a damn fool to say, come, my friend? And so, have been marred and scarred by the system of racism, we talk about people who are prejudiced, people who prejudge a situation, people who are powerless to develop a system to deny and give vengeance to you for the systems that you develop. You are talking about people who do not have the potential to ever be called racist, not in modern day and times. Why is it important for us to understand the system of racism? Because these are the systems that control your life. These are the systems that will decide for you whether or not your people will survive into the year 2000 and beyond that. These are the systems that decided for Indians that they would not survive. These are the systems that rob groups of people of their land, their heritage, their culture, and their language. White supremacy. Public Enemy has an album out called In Fear of a Black Planet. There is a particular reason why the album is called In Fear of a Black Planet. It is based on the theories of Dr. Francis Cress Welsing and Nellie Fuller, which says that there is a fear, a fundamental fear in Europeans, a fundamental fear in white people about the prospering, the livelihood, and the creation of African people. Well, what is this fear based on? She says that this fear is based on fear of genetic annihilation. To break it down more, fear that when an African man integrates with a European woman, you get an African baby. As the song on the album says, black man, black woman, black baby. Black woman, black man, black baby. White man, black woman, black baby. White woman, black man, black baby. Because of the dominance of the African gene, because of the dominance of the melanin in the gene, any other culture that integrates with it can only produce us. And that causes a fear that would make people who are in power to use their system to destroy people who do not have the power to destroy them, for fear of the fact that if everybody had plentiful resources and everybody had the proper education, that they may in fact disappear from the face of the earth. Because they can never reproduce themselves through us. If you touch us, you become us. And that's a powerful dilemma. Capitalism. What is the definition of capitalism? And what do you get when you have a society that integrates racism, white supremacy, and capitalism in one big global system? You have America. Capitalism is a system that is designed to put money over all things. Money before God, money before family, money before life, money before everything. Capitalism is a system that will rape and pillage other countries, kill people, rob people, do anything by any means necessary in search of the dollar and wealth. White supremacy, racism, and capitalism are the number three killers, which is why I say that we as a people exist in a state of war because these systems have declared war against our very existence and survival inside of America. Racism, white supremacy, and capitalism. So what happens if we reject our African selves? If we reject ourselves, we are in a state of confusion. You have African women who want to be African men. You got African men who want to be African women. You got African children who don't know what to be because their African parents are so crazy. How are you going to figure out the dilemmas that face you in life if you reject yourself? We have a so-called war situation in the Persian Gulf. And one thing that we know as African people is that we must study our history. And in studying our history, we know that we are always disproportionately represented in the military. We also know that we're disproportionately represented because we're economically oppressed and usually we end up there trying to make a dollar to survive. The army says be all that you can be. And in America, for a lot of black men, that is all that they can be. And so what you have is a black soldier out in the desert over there in Kuwait, looking through the barrel of the gun, never had liberation in America, never had respect in America, civil rights bill vetoed in America, won't have anything when he gets back, left his family to go up there, lived in the projects, grew up in the projects to die in the desert, fighting a war for somebody else. That is a brother or a sister who has been confused and dominated and manipulated by racism, white supremacy, and capitalism. And for George Bush to convince you that it is because he wants a kinder and gentler nation, it is because he is concerned about the liberation of Kuwait. This is a trick. And not only that, it is one lie compiled on a history and a legacy of liars. A history and legacy of liars to African people to maintain white supremacy, racism, and capitalism. So what do you do when you have a war situation? When you have a war situation, you have to draw on what has happened historically for African people to develop systems of rebellion. What does that mean? That you have to acknowledge, first of all, that in a war situation, you have friends and you have enemies. That means that you can't get advice from your enemies in a war situation. That means that you have to know who your enemies are in a war situation. And you have to know who your friends are. If you don't know the difference between your friends and your enemies, you will most definitely be somebody's sucker because you will love your enemies and you will destroy your friends. So in a war situation, you must know the difference between the two. The other thing you must do is draw on the stories of the past. Harriet Tubman was an African woman who designed and assisted in developing an underground system, Underground Railroad. What was an Underground Railroad? An Underground Railroad was a network and system of houses designed to hide African people in a time of unrighteous laws made by an unrighteous man of an unrighteous system against righteous people. That was an Underground Railroad. So that means in 1991, if you have the same unrighteous laws and the same unrighteous system and the same unrighteous people, raining war against the same righteous people, you must have an Underground Railroad. An Underground Railroad is a network and a system and a series of places that we as African people can go to rebel against an unrighteous system created by unrighteous men. And so when I say an Underground Railroad, you have to know that even in the future, as wars come about, that when you are drafted, you cannot be at the place where the government would most likely find you. You have to be somewhere else. You cannot turn yourself into your enemies. And you cannot accept advice from your enemies. Of course your enemies are going to tell you you can either fight or you can go to jail. If I were your enemy, would I give you any other options? But If you are smart and you are wise, you don't accept advice from your enemies. So if they say A, go to war, or B, go to jail, you know that your African creativity must develop a C, D, E, F, and G. An alternative rooted in your community, controlled by your African mind, to save your African ass from this man. When we talk about building a movement, what then becomes the barriers to us building a movement? Some of the barriers are that we don't have basic understanding of all of the definitions that I've discussed. And so what we have is, we say let's have a movement, but brothers and sisters can't even get along. Brothers and sisters can't even get over the first hump of trying to put a mechanism together. And so you have African women and African men. Now, if African men take their lead from white men, what will happen is they will believe in the exploitation of women. What will be common words in the African community are bitches, hoes, skeezers, things of that nature. Because you see, if you understood your African self, you would understand that Africa, first of all, was the origin of all civilization. Any form of life anywhere in the world had to come from the origin first. And if Africa is the origin of civilization, is it not through my womb through which everything exists? That you respect, honor, love, and protect that particular species. And so what happens is, if African men take their definitions from a system that is dominated by white supremacy, racism, and capitalism, you will never be able to relate to an African woman. But what about the African women? Because African women make the same mistake. African women cannot take their definition of womanhood from a white feminist movement that is divorced. Oh, yeah. African women have got to be wise enough to formulate their own strategies and their own beliefs and their own understanding and their own philosophy. To me, that in the white feminist movement, there seems to be a lot of hostility against men. Now, I would be mad if I were a white woman, and I would be mad if I had to sleep with the devil every night. and create balance. Anything else is the antithesis of what is supposed to happen with our people. Now, if you are confused, and you have been confused by these people, I can understand why, because they are very confusing. But you have a responsibility to look at yourself and understand how you got to be in the state of mind in which you exist. And every day is a struggle to make yourself a better person based on what you have at your fingertips to correct and control your situation. What does that mean? That means that in our search for dignity, in our search for understanding, we will be confused by the mechanisms that these people have created. However, because the public library system is free, we have access to a proper education, despite what any professor has given to us to study. You have the individual independence of choosing the proper information to educate yourself. So if you don't understand life and womanhood, and if you don't understand children and manhood, and if you don't understand these things, you must make it your responsibility to find out. But I will assure you, if you take your cues from them, you will start to look strange, you will start to act strange, you will return to your community and you will be rejected by your own people, because you will think that you're organizing them, and you will think that you're struggling with them, and they will think that you are stock raving mad. As African people, we have got to get along. There's nothing else that you have as an African woman but your man, and as an African man but your woman. Now, we get confused, you know, because we take somebody else's history and try to make it our own. But African men have got to understand that we as African women have always understood that our relationship to you is by your side and your relationship to us is by our side. During slavery, African women laid down with white oppressors and had sex, felt repulsive to save the African man, still looked her African man in the eye and respected and loved him, even though she had to defile her own body that he might exist. African women understood that we were in this predicament together. It was an African woman that broke from Maryland to Canada, which is however many thousands. It was an African woman that put guns to African men's heads and said, I know that you've been psychologically indoctrinated and rearranged by this system. I know that you've been devastated by white racism and white supremacy. I know that these things have destroyed your mind, but you're coming with me, and if you don't, it's freedom or death, but you'll die right here on the dot. It was African women who did that. It was our children and your children who were sold. And so we have an intricately interwoven reality. When I say I, it means we, and we means I means them, and them means they, and they means us, and us is we, and us is I, and you is them, and you am I, and I am you. That means that whatever happens to you happens to me. So when you meet a young African student in a university like this who feels that they have so many opportunities to live and survive and thrive, who says racism? Education. America, foreign policy, 1914 to present. So what I had to do was read everything that they had on the syllabus, and I had to go back and read everything that I knew that as an African woman I must read. So when I take an exam, I have to say, according to Gutenberg, such and such happened in 1916. According to W.E.B. Du Bois, something else happened in 1916. So you show that you can gain mastery over their academic foundations, but you must gain mastery over yourself to at least have rights and passions to exist in the society. Because what is the definition of a man and what is the definition of a woman? The definition of an African man is somebody who can control his environment, somebody who can manipulate his own affairs, somebody who can provide for that which he produces on this earth, his offspring, somebody that can gain mastery over his lower self and lower desires and weaknesses and perversions. That is the definition of a man. The definition of a woman, somebody who can gain mastery over her lower self, lower desires and weaknesses. Somebody who can manipulate her environment, somebody who can provide for that which she produces. These definitions are critical. And if you're not in the educational system that is teaching you how to do these things, then you must seek these things for yourself. And you must know that in America, this knowledge is free. But the system has done such a sufficient job of psychologically devastating and rearranging you that they can keep the library free, keep the information you need in there, and not even worry about you ever finding out. What then will we do as a people to develop our communities in a better state? That we have to understand that the biggest barrier to our own liberation is in our minds. Because when you're under a system of white supremacy, you start to believe that the white man is all powerful. You start to believe that white people are gods on earth. You get on their planes and you're in awe of the technological advancement. You get in their laboratories and you're in awe of the technological advancement. And if you don't understand the systems, you won't understand how it is that they advance in this particular way. If you don't understand that it's easy to advance, if for 400 years you have 400 years of free labor, and while I'm out in the field picking your cotton and serving your food and weaning your babies and taking care of your man, and of course you can think of all types of things like flying planes and hooking up laboratories and blowing people up and things of this nature. Because ideas and creativity come out of at least some time to commune with yourself and your thoughts and your nature. But if you as African people and we as African people spend a disproportionate amount of our time serving a master interest, of course we will not be able to serve that time developing ourselves and our community. So we have to be careful that we don't buy into the misnomers and the stereotypes and the myths that the system creates that makes us think that these people are actually superior to us. Most African people, if you ask them to close their eyes and picture God, they will picture somebody white with long blonde hair that probably looks like he attends San Francisco State. And you don't have to admit it to me, but when you go home, close your eyes and make a picture of God and ask yourself what you see. And if what you see is what I just described, then you know that you are racism and capitalism and psychological indoctrination and manipulation, and you're probably in a state of accommodation, which means that you're in conflict with self-preservation, and self-preservation is the first law of nature. And so if you're not for yourself in your own community, how is it that you can preserve yourself in your own community? And if you're not for yourself, you're in conflict with nature. So how does that build into coalitions and organizing and things of that nature? Well, you see, the problem with African people is that we come into coalitions not even understanding who we are. We don't know that we're African. We have a vague idea, but we reject that fact. We usually talk about our Irish grandfathers or some Indian hairs that we have down by our neck or strange things. So here you are, you have an African person that comes to join a coalition. They're already confused and upset because they wonder if they look the right way, and they wonder, are they talking the right way? And they wonder, you know, can they say what they feel, and can I think what I think, and is like what I think wrong, and is how I look right, and all these types of things, but you want to join a coalition, you see. So the Korean comes to the table and he says, yes, I want to control the fruit and vegetable market. And the Chinese man comes to the table and he says, yes, I want to control the fish industry. And the Italian comes to the table and he says, yes, I would like to control the restaurant business and all the liquor licenses. And the Jewish man comes to the table and he says, yes, I'd like to control the banking system. And then the African man comes to the table and he says, oh, my name is Rafiki, I'm just so happy to be here. I'm so happy to be included. I'm not mad at anybody, you know. I believe that we should do unto others as they do to us. And so African people are taught to think on an emotional level, not on the level of self-interest and business. So what happens is other people calculate what they want out of a certain scenario. Other people calculate what type of business interest they have at the table. But African people are raised on certain hymns and songs and slogans. I have a dream. Slogans, do unto others. Slogans, we are the world. Slogans. But everything in America is business. How can you be about slogans when these people are about business? How can you get up from the table at a coalition without having anything? You didn't bring anything to the table and you don't leave the table with anything. But then if you don't want to participate in the coalition, they'll call you a racist. How can you be in the coalition if you don't even know who you are? Why should you be in the coalition if you can't get up from the table with anything? Why should they ask you to be in the coalition if they know that you don't bring anything to the table? Why? Because you make them look good. You make them look good when you're at the table because they can say that they at least included you. They consulted you and asked you how you felt. And you were there when they made all those white supremacist, racist, capitalist decisions. And they'll tell you that. He was there. He voted for it to make themselves look good. And so what my advice to African students become is that we have to find out who we are, first and foremost. We have to learn to relate to one another, first and foremost. The men with the women and the women with the men first and foremost before we can integrate with anybody. Otherwise, anybody can stamp their lifestyle on your face and you will wear it well. And you will not even know that you're in a state of confusion and you will not even know that you are other than yourself. You will not even know that you're divorced from your culture and you will not even know that you're divorced from your philosophy. You will not even know that you're divorced from your continent and your power base and the way you're supposed to look and act and think and live and relate to God and nature. You will not even know. You will be running around here thinking you're somebody that you're not and thinking that you're thinking and you won't even be thinking because your thoughts have already been decided by a system that was created to destroy you and a system that was created to get you to aid and abet in your own destruction. And so if we understand that everything in America is a business, we understand that we must organize businesses in order to survive. What do I mean by that? How many people saw The Godfather? What did the Italians do? They came into a community, they developed a product, olive oil, they organized around it, they made it a business. We have to have our own products. We can't continue to be the number one consumers on earth. Not and say, give me some respect. And they also understood that just because you have a business doesn't mean that you keep a business because we as African people had businesses, you know. We had businesses before they invaded Africa and we had businesses after we were slaves in America during the Reconstruction era. But what we didn't understand is just because you play by the rules and you do the right thing and you develop these businesses and you prosper doesn't mean that these people are going to leave you alone. In a state of war, people try to seize that which belongs to you. So if you develop a business, you also have to have a military infrastructure to protect the business. When the white man in The Godfather started to exploit other people, what did he say? He said, he has guns, but we have guns. They understood that they had to protect that which was theirs. They understood that they had to have a relationship between the business people and the political people. See, in the African community, what we do is we have some people that are involved in politics and they're absolutely filthy broke. And we have some people that are involved in business and they absolutely exploit everybody. And neither of the groups talks to one another. So since we don't understand it, we have to have a multidimensional infrastructure that business has got to talk to the political sector and political sector has got to talk to the educational sector and so on and so on and so forth. Our community is not organized in a way in which it's in the interest of self-preservation. It's organized in a way which is quite the opposite. So we as African students have got to understand that if you're going to be a doctor and you're an African, you have to be a doctor that is a doctor in the interest of African people. What does that mean? That you are interested in cures for the particular diseases that affect melanated cells at a higher voracity. You are interested in solving the particular medical problems of the African community. AIDS is a disease that you're concerned about. AIDS is a disease that you understand affects the majority of African people. AIDS is a disease that has been marketed as a faggot disease, but it isn't a disease that destroys disproportionately a majority of African people. AIDS is a disease that takes white supremacy, racism, and capitalism and rolls it all up into one big bowl. Here's the trick. They tell you, here we have AIDS. We got it from the Africans. You know they were playing with those green monkeys. You know, those green monkeys were there for centuries, but all of a sudden the Africans and the monkeys started getting it on. And because of a flea that the green monkeys had, that's how everybody got AIDS. You see, then they developed cures, supposed cures or alleged cures, and they went out and tested it on the African people in the continent of Africa. Gave them injections and all of a sudden everybody had AIDS. You see, so if you don't understand that you're in a state of war, you'll take inoculations from your enemy, you know. If you don't understand that you're in a state of war, you'll let these little organizations come in and test your children. If you don't understand that you're in a state of war, you'll always befriend your enemies and you'll destroy your friends. And so we as African students have to realize, if you're an African lawyer, if you're a black man or woman here that wants to be a lawyer, you have got to design creative legal styles to destroy a system which is erected off of the back of young black men, which is financed and bankrolled off of the backs of young black men. You can't just get a law degree and just fall in line, because you'll be in part and parcel in the destruction of your own people. If you're an African student that's in accounting, you have got to develop management skills and accounting systems which create business infrastructure in the African community. You've got to take young African children who have just mothers and no fathers, who see no business transacted in their homes, teach them how to add a checkbook, how to organize a computer system. You've got to tell them. In the absence of you telling them, they will not know. In the absence of you building it, it won't exist. Because nobody, none of your enemies, are going to come and design these systems and structures for you. And it doesn't matter how much we protest. Your enemies are not going to design systems and structures for you. If you are an African engineer, you have got to develop ways of us having self-sufficient communities where you don't have to get your water and food supply from your enemies. Because in a state of war, of course I'm going to damage your food supply. In a state of war, of course you're going to have more metallic substances in your water. In a state of war, of course I'm going to manipulate all of your resources. But if you don't believe that you're in a state of war and you don't know the difference between your friends and enemies, of course you're going to allow the white population to produce more and more engineers, and you won't do anything about it. And if you do become an engineer, you'll just join their corporations and do the same thing they do, even though the same thing that they do is not for you and your people, because you're in contradiction with your self-preservation, because you didn't even know you were in a state of war. So you're healthy. Independent educational structures that take into account African ways and philosophies. Am I talking about the exterior? No, I'm not talking about African garb and turbans and things of that nature. I'm talking about an understanding of the mind and the spirit and a particular way of life. I'm talking about building structures of self-sufficiency. And so I would like to close by saying that we as African people have a particular responsibility. We cannot define ourselves off of the backs of other people in the society. We have got to understand that we're in a particular situation. You can't say, well, white people do it, because white people are not in the same predicament as us. We have a particular responsibility. As an artist in the entertainment industry, one thing that I say is we have a debate over art and responsibility. That we gotta understand that you can say that you're an artist, but as an African, you always have a responsibility. Why? Because the struggle continues. And without agitation, we will have nothing. We will have nothing. And so I'd like to say peace to you all and thank you for your attention.
catch to kind of keep them brief, please. I want to go ahead and thank her on behalf of the sister and the African student council and of all the students, African students here at State and any other students who came by to listen to this message. We want to thank you, Sister Soldier, Sister Lisa, and we want to thank Sister Jill and Sister Jenna for bringing here on
questions? All right, when people don't have questions.
Here we go. Huh?
Oh, you got a question. Okay.
First of all, I'd like to thank you for your message.
Thank you.
You discussed a lot of themes about war and about who we are. One of the problems that I face most often in dealing with other Africans is that of personal accountability. Could you talk a little bit about how you feel about that?
Personal accountability. I'm not sure specifically what you mean by that, but I can answer it to the best of my ability. I think that a lot of times how we're raised plays into how responsible or accountable we become as adults. And I can give an example for myself because my family was on welfare for so long. I never saw certain things happen, like checkbooks being balanced. I never saw certain things happen in terms of bills being paid because it was kind of a thing like we didn't have anything, so we didn't have anything to give. Because we were alive, of course, we utilized things even though we couldn't pay for them. And so in becoming an adult, I had to learn personal accountability due to the fact that that was not something that I usually saw transacted. So I think a lot of the problems that we have come out of the systems and the structures of the way we were raised. But I think one helpful thing to do is at the end of each day, I try to ask myself, have I done the right thing? You know, have I done the right things on this particular day? If I haven't, how could I have avoided these particular situations? And if I did something wrong or somebody else did something wrong, to understand why it is that these people are behaving this way based on my historical understanding of what has transpired to us as a people. So I guess it's just a thing where you have to challenge yourself on a daily basis to be better or to do better or to try harder in terms of becoming personally accountable.
You had discussed how capitalism affects people. That's really clear to all of us. But you had also said that blacks should have their own businesses. So are you saying that blacks should use capitalism for their own benefit? Or were you thinking more in terms of the socialist kind of system?
What I'm thinking is this, that there's nothing wrong with having businesses as long as they're built on a particular philosophy. I think what happens is when you enter the capitalist arena, not knowing who you are or what you're about or what you should be about or how your businesses should be organized and constructed, then you become part of a system that is already designed or that preceded you. I think if you understand who you are, then you come into the system building things in a particular way. Now, the reason why I wouldn't use the word socialist is because some of these isms, you know, that people have come up with, socialism, communism, and all this other stuff. Usually those isms have also been controlled by Europeans. So how they've been constructed and how they've been made manifested is not something that you control, and it's not something that I control. Because even if you had a country in Africa that had a revolution and then erected a socialist government, they were stuck in an international economic system that controlled their particular reality. So what I'm saying is that we as African people definitely have to have businesses for basic fundamental survival. And I believe that one of the mistakes of the movement has been that we disavow ourselves from money. We don't want to have anything to do with money. So as a result, when we get in a jam, we can't even organize our way out of a jam. If you're in America where everything is a business and you want to have flyers for a program and you don't have money for flyers, you're going to have problems. And if you're in a highly technological era where flyers almost don't even make a difference and you need to control some records or you need to control some filmmaking or you need to control videos, if you don't have any basic capital, you can't even begin to strategize against the war that has been put against your people. So it is important to have an economic infrastructure. Also that students have a habit of being so far removed from the community that they don't understand how the average black kid will think, the average black student. And so what'll happen is, you get to college and you get all of these idealistic things about, oh, you're gonna be the socialist with no money, and you're gonna be this with no money. And then you go back to the kid and the kid says, well, look, you went to school for all these years and you don't have a damn thing. Now you wanna come back and tell me how to run my life, you know, and what you think about this, but I don't even care what you think about this because you don't even have any money and you went to school and you can't even develop a way to feed yourself. And so you get college students coming out of institutions like these and they're inept and they don't have any practical skills and they don't know how to organize anything in a particular way or fashion. So when you get the drug dealers on the corner and you're trying to get the drug dealers off the corner, who's gonna have a better approach? You can say, brother, I'd like you to check out this book, The Crisis of the Negro Intellectual, and I'd like you to read some W.E.B. Du Bois' Pan-Africanism, and I'd like you to get, you know, hook up with Kwame Ture and Sekou Dinga and all these people, right? But you still can't tell a brother how to produce a product that will not destroy himself and be able to survive at the same time. So the question becomes, can you, as a college student, design practical systems and businesses to help our people to survive? So yes, I am saying that you must manipulate some type of a capitalist, some type of a business structure in order to get to a certain point with African people in the movement.
Yes, microphone. Can you hear me? One of the themes in Public Enemy is the whole accountability and misinformation given out by the media. Mm-hmm. And I want to know from your perspective, what do you think that African people should be doing? How they should first interpret the media, and if there's misinformation that's given out, how they should go about counterattacking that so that we don't get even more confused.
Mm-hmm. I think there should always be a multi-tiered strategy towards any type of oppression. Meaning that you can boycott something, you can make yourself not be a consumer of something that's projecting you in a negative way. And then you can also build so that you can be the manipulator, you can be on the side of the manipulation in the years to come. So I think that our plans have to be long-range strategies. For instance, I think that sometimes our elders in the movement don't realize that they did create some victories. You get somebody like a Spike Lee who, you know, everybody might not agree with all of his views, but that's a victory because you have now a black man in a position where he can at least manipulate some images to a particular degree to impact the psyche of African people. So I think what has to happen is that we have to infiltrate the media. I mean, the only reason why I'm a member of Public Enemy is because I know it will give me the ability as a young African woman to put a message out to African people worldwide and they will receive it at the same time. And so that's an international communication network. And when I'm looking at spending one day making a video, it took us one day to make the Buck Wilder video. And I'm looking at the fact that in one day, I generated a message that's gonna go to all these countries in the world. And as an activist, I spent many days and nights on foot giving out flyers, knocking on doors, so that it could ever reach as many people on foot or with flyers as I could by manipulating the communication system. So I think that we have to, in any career that you have to ask yourself the fundamental question of how does this serve the interests of African people and how can I, as an African person, produce something that will serve the needs and the interests of our people? And if you can't answer that question, you're probably in the wrong place.
Hello, Sister Soldier. I'd like to welcome you to our school. I heard you briefly mention Pan-Africanism, and that's something I'm interested in. So I was wondering, I mean, you're saying that we are at war, and this is a fact, and do you feel that African people on this continent can actually succeed in a struggle, in a battle, and win this war independent of our African brothers and sisters all around the world?
No, I wouldn't say independent of. I also believe in Pan-Africanism, and I believe that African people, every place in the world must be struggling for the total liberation of Africa. I think what happens with us is that we look for short-term gratification. So a lot of times we say, well, Africa, a united Africa, that's like inconceivable because you start to think about the fact that there are so many languages on the continent and
the IMF and all of these people have manipulated, and AIDS and this and that, and you become overwhelmed. But one of the military strategies that I developed for myself is that even though you're way behind, and even though it may look like you can never triumph, you must start at the beginning. You must start at the beginning. And starting at the beginning is number one, don't panic. You can't panic, because once you panic, you lose your clarity, your ability to produce proper solutions. So you don't panic. And the second thing that you do is you start at the beginning. To give you an example, when Japan was devastated, and I remember back in the 60s where they had these radios, if you had a Japanese radio, it was like a joke. Or if something, for instance, was made in Taiwan, it was like a joke. If, you know what I'm saying? Like, oh, you got one of them cheap radios or whatever. Now you look in 1991, if you got a Japanese product, you doing all right. You know, because they said, okay, we'll start with the transistor radios. It may seem like a joke to you, and we may have to sell it for $5 or whatever, but the more you buy, the more we build our economic infrastructure, and now they own Rockefeller Center, and MCA, Bobby Brown, and Heavy D, Du Bois, CBS, and Regina Bell, and all these American institutions. And so I think that what has to happen is African people worldwide have to recognize that we're African and unite, recognize that even if we hate and reject ourselves because of miseducation, nobody else will embrace us. And if they embrace us on the surface level, it will not mean anything substantively. It will not mean anything on a comprehensive level. Because you can walk back and forth to school with Jane means nothing. You know, what does she think about affirmative action, and who did she vote for in the last election? And is she willing to give up any of her money in reparations that are owed to you and your people because of her ancestral problems? You see, those things become assessments of power. So I think that all African people have to recognize that we are connected, and that we have to develop Africa. When we say develop Africa, we mean do business. What kind of products does Africa need? I'm telling you, I lived in Zimbabwe, and if somebody opened up a shoe store in Harare, they would be a multimillionaire. I'm telling you that. Because the majority of shoes, they come from Europe, and they stop at size 9. And the majority of African women have larger feet. And so you got all these stores over there that cannot even serve the population. Now that might seem simple, but that's a business that can become a multi-billion dollar international reality, that whose monies and proceeds can help you militarily, can help get you out of a predicament. But because we don't think of in terms of business, you know, that's a problem. I remember when Minister Farrakhan said he was gonna make toilet paper and soap. People thought that was a joke. If you think that's a joke, you write to Procter & Gamble and find out how much money they made making those products, and how many people they oppress making those products, and how many people they control making those products. So I say that African people, we have to begin to think in terms of our own interests, and definitely economically speaking, but rooted in an African spiritual base.
Listening to all of your comments, I appreciate them all. And one in particular, you were talking about the confusion that we are our existence in terms of our relation to oneself as African men and women. And that you have African women who want to be more like African men, and you have, to some degree, African men who want to be like African women. And that confusion is transgressed to the children, and how do we expect them to, you know, develop as African people living in that confusion? I was hoping that you could talk a little more about that, and that the relationship that exists between African men and women. Men respected the qualities, the God-given qualities that are given to men, and African women respecting the God-given qualities to African men.
Right. I think because of the state of our leadership, most of our leadership is bought and controlled. And also because America is organized in terms of lobby interests, you get people that organize. What happens is you get a group of organized homosexuals, and then you get black people who want to respond to that, and you get silenced. Because the power lobby is too much for you to say what you really think, because you're scared of the ramifications, the political ramifications of that. You understand? So my point is, just like homosexuals say that they have First Amendment rights and freedom of speech and protest, and they want this and they want that, I also have the right to disagree. I have the right to disagree. And I have the right to express that if this is going to impact the young population of my community in a particular way, that yes, I take exception to that. And if you want to turn around and be a name caller and say, well, you're homophobic, I say, well, yes, I fear a society where this becomes the norm. Yes, I do. So it becomes a thing like, if we're all scared to say what we really feel, and we're all scared to say what we really think, and those people who are confused don't ever try to find out the right answers, how can we live and grow together? So I think what has to happen is that if people had more confidence in themselves and developed themselves better and search for answers within themselves, we wouldn't all be imitators. It's like you see one person and you find out what they're doing and what they're involved in, and everybody follows her down the street. Or you see one guy, you see what he's involved in, what he's doing, everybody follows him down the street. But you can't do it that way. You gotta find out, how did you get here? Who was your mother? Who was your grandmother? Who was your great-grandmother? How did they live? Why did it work for them? Why didn't it work for them? What were the pluses and what were the minuses? And in terms of African men and women, I couldn't really say it any stronger than I already have, is that the bottom line is that we are each other's greatest allies. There is no, way that people should be able to manipulate us into believing that you got women over here and men over here. You have to realize that European society teaches you to compartmentalize everything. What that means is put everything in sections. But African society is based on a circular philosophical base. It's on a principle called Maat, which is M-A-A-T, which is based on balance and reciprocity. So in a search of Maat, balance and reciprocity, and a circular development, you understand that there's no women over here, men over here, children over there. You look at the European community, the children are flipping out on the parents, the women are flipping out on the men are flipping out on the women. That's not how you have a stable situation. That's not my, that's not balance, and it's not based on reciprocity. It's based on some other type of thing. But in the European community, you can't even grow up. You can't even get old. Once you turn 30, you're useless. According to European philosophy, once you turn 30, you're useless. You get old, you go to a nursing home. You're a woman and you don't like your husband, you shave your head and you run around the place with t-shirts on and cigarette packs up here. The curse of the devil. You understand what I'm saying? I have problems with that. That you gotta find your own ways based on your own reality of expressing yourself. When African women get together, and we gotta talk about a war on our men. There is a war on our men. We on campuses, half of us sharing half a man that was left. The jail system is a system for prisoners of war. So you got all these black men locked up in prisons. Even in white states where there are no black people, 80% of the prison is black men. And so when we get together as sisters, you can't be so hung up on the sexism thing that you think you can't discuss the actual fact that there is a war against your man. There is a war against your man, the actual fact.
When they glisten, they'll pay attention, best Aspen bees, father, I'm a ghost. In the killing fields, Hail Mary, catch me if I go. Let's go deep inside the solitary mind of a madman. Screams in the dark, evil lurks, enemies see me flee. Activate my hate, let it break till I'm flaming. Set trip, empty out my clip, never stop to aim. Some say the game is all corrupted, fucked in this shit. Stuck, niggas is lucky if we bust out this shit. Plus, mama told me never stop until I bust a nut. Fuck the world if they can't adjust. It's just as well. Hail Mary, come with me. Hail Mary, nigga, run quick, see. What do we have here now? Do you wanna ride or die? La da 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 da. Come with me. Hail Mary, nigga, run quick, see. What do we have here now? Do you wanna ride or die? La da 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 da. Penitentiaries is back with promise makers. Never realized the precious time that bitch niggas is wasting. Institutionalized, I live my life a product made to crumble. Much too hardened for a smile. Way too crazy to be humble. We ballin', catch me, Father, please, cause I'm ballin'. In the liquor store, that's the Hennessy I hear callin'. Can I get some more? Hell, till I reach hell, I ain't scared. Mama checkin' in my bedroom, I ain't there. I got a head with no screws in it. What can I do? One life to live, but I got nothing to lose. Just me and you, on a one way to rip the prison. Selling drugs, we all wrapped up in this living. Like the studs, to my homeboys and Clinton Max, doing they bid. Raise hell to this real shit, and feel this. When they turn out the lights, I'll be there in the dark. Lugging eternal through my heart. Now Hail Mary, nigga, come with me. Hail Mary, nigga, run quick, see. What do we have here now? Do you wanna ride or die? La da 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 da. Come with me. Hail Mary, nigga, run quick, see. What do we have here now? Do you wanna ride or die? La da 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 da.
They got an APB out on my thug family. Since outlaws run these streets like these scandalous freaks. Our enemies dying now, walking around half dead, head down. K blasted off a hand. Blistered and high, visions of me, thug living, getting me by, forever live, and I multiply, survived by thugs, when I die, they won't cry, unless they coming with slugs.
Peep the whole scene, and whatever's going on around me, brain kinda cloudy, smoked out, feeling rowdy, ready to wet the party up, and whoever in that motherfucker, nasty new street, slugger, my heat, Zeke suckers on the regular, mashing in a stolen black act, Integra, cock back, 60 seconds to the draw, that's when I'm dead in your feet first. You got a nice gap, but my heat's worse. From a thug to preaching church, I gave you love, now you eating dirt, needing work. And I ain't the nigga to put you on, cause word is born. When I was broke, I had to hustle till dawn, that's when the sun came up. It's only one way up, hold your head, stay up. To all my niggas, get your pay and wait up.
If it's on, then it's on. We rake, be breaks, outlaws on the paper chase. Can you relate to the shit I don't got? Be the shit I gotta take. Dealing with fate, hoping God don't blow the gate. If it's on, then it's on. We rake, be breaks, outlaws on the paper chase. Can you relate to the shit I don't got? Be the shit I gotta take. Dealing with fate, hoping God don't blow the gate.
Traveling on this weary road. Sometimes life will be a heavy load. But we ride, riding like a bullet.
Hail Mary, Hail Mary. Hail Mary.
We won't worry, everything will hurry. We're free like a bird in the tree. We won't worry, everything will curry. Yes, we're free like a bird in the tree. We're running from the penitentiary. This is the time for we leave. Hail Mary, Hail Mary.